Good morning and welcome to River of Life Online. My name is Brent Hudson and we are so glad that you've joined us here today for this third week of Advent. Today our theme is joy. Join us. For this third week of Advent, our reading is from Isaiah 12, 2-6. See, God has come to save me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. The Lord God is my strength and my song. He has given me victory. With joy you will drink deeply from the fountain of salvation. In that wonderful day you will sing, thank the Lord, praise his name. Tell the nations what he has done. Let them know how mighty he is. Sing to the Lord, for he has done wonderful things. Make known his praise around the world. Let all the people of Jerusalem shout his praise with joy. For great is the Holy One of Israel who lives among you. As I mentioned earlier, today, of the third week of Advent, we are looking at joy. And I want you to take a piece of paper or pull out your phone or device, and I want you to write down just a few things that have brought you joy in recent memory. And I just get you to press pause as you do that, and when you're done doing that, we'll resume. Okay, you all have your list. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to have you hold on to that for a minute because we're going to come back to it later. Joy is such an interesting thing, isn't it? The vast majority of people know exactly what joy is, but very few of us, and maybe no one really, can actually tell others what it is, explain it. It's kind of like the love that you feel for another person. I mean, you know when you are in love, but you don't maybe know how to talk about what that feeling is like or describe that to someone else who perhaps hasn't or doesn't understand that feeling. You know, I always had trouble remembering which week in the Advent cycle the pink candle was for. And of course, the Advent themes of hope, peace, joy, and love, you know, all are major parts of the Christian life. So it's always a bit strange to me, always has been, that there was just one that stood out as pink. And of course, I'm sure there are liturgical reasons for that. But as someone who's not steeped in that tradition, it always seemed a bit strange to me. Now, I recently heard that joy is pink because it's on the third week, and just as the vestments and colors change in the third week of Advent or Lent, so too they do in Advent. But that's, again, that's a correlation, not so much an explanation. Is it because of the number three? Is it because on the third day Jesus was raised from the dead? Is it because of the triune nature of the Godhead? I honestly don't know. But there it is, the pink candle, just sitting there on the wreath saying, look at me, I'm different. And you know, it's a good thing, too, that it falls on this idea or theme of joy, because in many ways, that's what joy is, isn't it? When a person's experiencing a joyful moment, they are certainly different from the ordinary mode or normal mode of their being and their living. I mean, can a person really experience deep, real joy and not smile at the same time? It just works its way out into our facial expressions. Often the best indicator if we're having a moment or an experience of joy is simply to see that smile that automatically happens almost out of nowhere. We look at a picture and it takes us back to a moment in time, or maybe we hear a song and our minds transport us back to a moment in the past in another place, but then we sort of re-experience some of the joy of that moment. Perhaps not to the same intensity, but it's like that memory sort of splashes us with some of those feelings. And for just a fleeting moment, we're there again, and we feel that joy, and we smile. And we become very similar to that pink candle to others, I think. You know, they're going to be looking at you in the moment like that, and they're going to ask, you know, what were you thinking about? Because they can tell that something shifted, something changed in that moment when that smile came across your face. I was researching joy for this message, and I happened upon a series of YouTube interviews by Miroslav Volf at Yale, where he interviews all these scholars about the topic of joy. And there are so many wonderful interviews with scholars on this topic. But one of them was Harold Attridge, and I have appreciated Professor Attridge for many years because of his expertise in the Greek language and his knowledge of classics and the way he relates all of that to understanding the New Testament. And Professor Attridge, when he was asked, what is joy, had a lot to say, but within his long professorial response, he said this: joy is a positive emotional response to things, but in the New Testament, joy functions not only this way, but also as a virtue. It's something we are called to practice. And so while the smile of the memory is somewhat spontaneous and perhaps fleeting, a splash of memory on us of a good moment in time previously, the Bible says that we're also called to practice a life that includes joy. Another scholar in that series of interviews from Yale was a musicologist, Daniel Chua. And he says that the experience of joy is not a goal in itself, but instead it is rooted together in love and faith and in hope. In other words, joy is part of a constellation of virtues, like the fruit of the Holy Spirit. They come together. It's a package deal. And so we know the experience of joy when it happens, and we're called to reproduce that in our lives by being joyful people. But how, if it's not something that can be pursued as a primary goal? And this is where I think the Christmas story helps us, and the pink candle of Advent challenges us. It challenges us to be people who are open to being surprised by joy. When we look at the Christmas story, many things are in the foreground that we focus on: Mary and Joseph, angels, shepherds, magi, just to name a few. But one thing that exists in the background that we often don't recognize, or at least call attention to it, is that all these things happen in the dark. At night, Christmas comes to us in the darkness of night. Joseph is sleeping, and he has a dream to not divorce his beloved. And it's while shepherds are watching their flocks at night that the angel army appears and makes an announcement about the coming Messiah. It's a stellar object composed of light that traverses the darkness of space that leads the Magi to offer their gifts to the newborn king of the Jews. But more than that, this all happened in a dark time in Israel. 100 years of independence had come to an end, and the Romans were now running the show in Israel. Once again, Israel is experiencing oppression, where the descendants of Abraham and the descendants of the great King David could routinely be crucified on street corners or mercilessly tortured whenever Roman officials thought it would be helpful to accomplish whatever particular goal they had at that moment. These were dark times in Israel, for sure. When I say that we all know what joy is when we experience it, I realize there are some people who may be handicapped in this area. Some may have gone so long without experiencing real, true joy that they've forgotten what it feels like. And yet when I say that, I don't think the same holds true for darkness, does it? We all know the pains of trauma, of abuse of some sort or another. We all know the pangs of grief and loss. We understand darkness, and we understand the feeling that comes with things that go bump in the night, as they say. And yet the Christmas story, it happens at night. It's in the darkness that God shines his brightest light for you and for me. And it can be a bit of a surprise when the light shines in the darkness. But more than that, I think it can even be a little uncomfortable, can it? I mean, who hasn't pulled the sheets up over their head when someone comes in the morning and turns on the light before we're ready to wake up? our eyes and our brains, they're just not ready for the light. We hide from it initially. I mean, we love it, we need it, but when we're in the dark and adjusted to the dark, even if it's an uncomfortable dark, the light hurts a little bit when it first comes on. You know, it's amazing, really, the ease at which we become acclimatized to the dark. But it's equally wonderful how we can adapt to the light, and how much more wonderful everything is in the light. In many ways, we're in dark times right now in our world. We've experienced restrictions and difficulties, and with Christmas coming, we're being told not to make too many plans. You know, it's a very difficult moment for a lot of people. Lives have been affected in so many ways by this pandemic. And yes, I'm going to blame the pandemic and not our health authorities or governing officials who are just simply trying to protect us from a potentially dangerous or deadly virus, and also from ourselves because we get fed up with rules so quickly. And we sometimes perhaps feel a little invulnerable about viruses and whatnot until, of course, it jumps around the corner and sucker punches us in the face and we wonder why we were so dumb. But anyway, that's another story. That's another message. I know that my own family, you know, we've had our share of struggles over the years and, you know, things I never thought we would have to go through and the pain of that just doesn't go away. It lingers and it will shape us and in the future. It's just here. It's a part of us now. And, you know, there are ways that it's going to affect us in that are still undiscovered. We don't even know yet the extent at which some of that pain and grief will land in our lives. And yet it's in that experience of darkness that God sends us His light. And Christmas reminds us of that psalm that we referenced, or I referenced in last week's message, Psalm 139:12. Even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. And the Christmas story really proclaims that, doesn't it? I mean, we certainly see that here with everything happening in the dark and God breaking through with His good news. And many of us have experienced that in our own lives, too, that God breaks through the night and touches us in ways that leave us changed. And so, back to the pink candle. And, you know, it reminds me of another one of the interviews that I saw last week as I was researching this message, where it's Willie Jennings from, actually, where is he from? Duke, I guess. And he says this about joy. He says that joy is an act of resistance against despair. And I love that. Joy is an act of resistance against despair. You know, as representatives of Christmas in this world, as people who announce that God's light has come into the world, we're like that pink candle in this world. We sort of stand out as a curiosity and an oddity in this world, to be sure. But yet standing out as representatives of those who have the joy of the Lord and joy in the Lord, people with good news in a world that's often captivated by bad news. You know, clearly Jesus envisions this in John 15 when he's teaching about the coming Holy Spirit. He says to his disciples, and he says it to us, "I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow." Jesus sees our joy as overflowing in proportion to our willingness to do what He says, which of course is to love one another. Again, we're reminded of that constellation of virtues that Daniel Chua mentioned in his interview. And I want to bring that together with what Harold Attridge said, that joy is not just an experience, it's also a virtue. It's something that doesn't just engage the heart. It engages the mind and the will as well. We must be people who are choosing joy. Now, we learn this even in our lectionary reading for this week. Like, let's listen to the words of Paul from Philippians. He says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. We see rejoicing connected to prayer and petition and to gratitude and the experience of peace. You know, truly that constellation of joy widens even further in this passage. But what comes out clearly is that rejoicing and joy are things that can occur in dismal moments of life. I mean, Paul wrote this letter from a Roman jail. Not really the best environment for rejoicing. I think most of us can agree with that. And yet, that's what we see. You know, when we read about Paul's imprisonment in Philippi in the book of Acts, I mean, this is where Paul and Silas were singing praises to God, and the door breaks open, and the jailer wants to hear the good news of God, and Paul says, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved." That's such an important verse in the Bible for me, because in my own faith journey, I started doubting that God had actually saved me. I didn't know if I actually was someone who could say that God would save. And I remember Sterling Gosman in Fredericton saying to me, well, he quoted that verse. And then he asked me, do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? And I said, yes. And he said, well, then you're saved. Simple as that. It's God's promise. It's God's work. You believe, God will do it. God's light breaks through the darkness. And I remember that moment just like it happened yesterday. And just like so many memories, it brings a bit of a smile on my face when I think about it. Because God does break through the darkness with his light. Paul and Silas rejoiced while they were in prison, and God moved and people were saved. And that story is still being used by God to save people today. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say it, rejoice. I think the words of Professor Nicholas Walterstorff are helpful at this point, and he's the final person that I want to refer to from those many interviews on Yale Symposium for Joy. And for many of you, perhaps, who are in Moncton or who have been around in this area, you might recognize that name because he was a speaker at Crandall University here in Moncton years ago for the Murray Lectures. And in those lectures, he talked about his book, Lament for a Son, where he shared deeply from his own experience of the death of his son in a climbing accident. And this experience in his life obviously continues to shape his theology and thinking, as deep grief shapes everyone's theology and thinking about things. And for Walterstorff, joy happens when people care about something being a certain way and when reality aligns to that certain way. And when that happens, it produces joy. You know, the more we care about something being a particular way, the more joy we experience when it happens that way, and more grief we experience when it doesn't. And this is why he says people can be joyful about the wrong things. And it's an emotion rooted in reality, but he also says that it's context independent, which means that we can be in a dark, damp prison in Philippi and still sing songs to the Lord and experience joy in our hearts, just like Paul and Silas did. Joy can happen in the darkness of night, not because of the darkness or the night, but independent of that. It's the angels announcing a newborn Messiah. It's the star leading the way to the King of the Jews. It's a song sung in a dismal place. It's a memory brought to the forefront during a difficult time. Every time I get a picture of one of my grandchildren, I smile. I feel a deep sense of joy. My feelings all catch up to me in that moment. Doesn't matter what's going on. I may be in a boring situation, watching a suspenseful movie. I may be feeling sad. But as soon as I see that photo, I have a taste of joy. A smile comes across my face. But what about you? Where are the bright spots in your life? Now, you remember back, I asked you to put on a piece of paper or on your device a list of things that brought you joy. I want you to take a look at that list, and I want you to think about those things right now. And I want you to add to it as necessary, because this is going to be your lifeline to experience a little bit of joy in whatever darkness may be surrounding you. It's going to remind you about what that feeling is. And we're going to redirect that over to the story of Christmas. Because the story of Christmas is one that we can always remember all year round. And that is that Emmanuel has come to you. And this is the ultimate reason for our joy, because it transcends everything else that's going on around us. You know, in our live service on Sunday, we sang the Christmas carol, O Come, Emmanuel. And I sang that on the first week of Advent. It's one of my favorite songs. We sang it on week one of Advent because I wanted to focus on the waiting aspect of Advent. But this week, I chose it for a different reason. It's because that song is played in a minor key. It has that sad feel to it. And yet, in the midst of that minor key song comes the refrain, "Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel has come to you, O Israel." When we see Paul and Silas singing in jail, we see that they know how to rejoice in a minor key. They're not happy about being in jail. In fact, Paul complains about it in the story in Acts. We see that. Paul says they were unjustly imprisoned. He states his case, he makes his case, and he successfully makes his case. But the point is that even while he was unjustly imprisoned and beaten, they sang the Lord's song when they were in prison. They rejoiced in the Lord always. And again, he said, rejoice. They lived what they told others to do. And there will always be seasons in life where life is being played out in a minor key. Rejoicing in a minor key is often what we need to do in this world, but it's something we must do. It's something we need to choose to do. It was in darkness that the angels came to the shepherds. The shepherds chose to go and see, to go and to seek out the one who was born King of the Jews. They chose to follow it. It was a dream in the dark of night of soul that Joseph was told by the angel to marry and protect the young woman Mary. But Joseph chose to obey the angelic warning. The song of joy often begins as a minor key in our lives. It's in the darkness that God shines his light. This Christmas, God calls us to choose joy as an act of resistance against despair. To be the pink candle in the world, standing out among everything else around us, singing these words, rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel has come to you. God's light has shone, and it is shining all around us. But will you and I focus on the dark of night? Or will we focus on the Christmas story? Will we choose to look at the prison and focus on the imprisonment and the injustice of it all? Or will we choose to sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? It really comes down to a choice. You see, we're not rejoicing about the darkness. Paul wasn't singing about how great it was to be in prison. He sang that despite the beatings, despite the persecution, despite the imprisonment. God had shone his light. What God was doing, no one could stop, not whips, not shackles, not prisons. Paul and Silas chose to sing the Lord's song in a strange land, and they invite us to join in with them, to rejoice in what the Lord has done, and it is doing, and will do, in the lives of people of goodwill, people of peace, people of hope. And now, as we look at this week, people of joy. And Christmas gives us joy. Emmanuel has come, and nothing will ever be the same again. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I'll say it, rejoice. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that you make joy possible because of Emmanuel with us. We thank you that into this darkness you sent your light, you sent your child, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us in this season with so many things going off the rails and so many disappointments that still await us in this season of people not showing up, people not being around. Many of us dealing with grief of people who are just not with us anymore. God, there are so many things that just hit us and cause us to sing in that minor key. But God, I pray that the words that come out of our mouths will be rejoice, rejoice, for Emmanuel has come. You have sent your light into this world. You have sent your life, your light into our lives. And we thank you for that. And we pray that as we think on those things, that a smile will come across our face, that we will experience that joy, and we will be your people in this world. In Christ's name. Well, thank you for joining us here at River of Life. Next week, we look at our fourth week of Advent and the candle of love. Join us then. Relevant, practical, authentic. River of Life.